Hello, and welcome to this free lesson from the Project Management Prepcast. I am Cornelius Fichtner, and I am the lead instructor. Thank you for your interest in our PMP exam training course. For over 45,000 students, the PM Prepcast was the right choice. This free session here will allow you to experience what the course is like, and you'll see that it is the right choice for you too. The greatest technological benefit that the PM Prepcast gives you over other online courses is the fact that it is a podcast that you can choose to download. This means that you can not only watch online, but even better, you can save all 150 lessons on your tablet or on your phone. In that way, your PMP training course is always in your pocket, no matter where you are, even if you are offline. Preparing for your PMP exam has never been easier. Like I said, it's the right choice. Please visit pmprepcast.com for all the details. And now, on with the show. Hello and welcome to the Project Management Prepcast, where you can use your ears and eyes to prepare for your exam. I'm your instructor, Cornelius Fichtner. In this lesson, we discuss the Estimate Activity Resources process. We go through the various types of resources that are estimated, several factors that influence activity resource estimating, and we discuss the process details and how you need to coordinate with other processes. This important process here will help you estimate and identify the type and quantities of human resources, equipment, materials, and supplies required to perform each of the schedule activities and the project as a whole. But first, let us see where we are in the overall PMBOK guide map. We are in Project Resource Management and, as the process name implies, in the Planning Process Group. And we are at the second process, Estimate Activity Resources, which is defined as the process of estimating team resources and the type and quantities of material, equipment and supplies necessary to perform project work. If you would like to follow along in your own PMBOK guide, please turn to pages 320 to 327. A central theme in Estimate Activity Resources is that you should have a thorough understanding of the resources required for each individual activity in order to achieve an accurate estimate of duration and costs for the project as a whole. In other words, if you understand the resource details at the activity level, then figuring out the total cost and duration will be a breeze. But if you fail to understand the required resources, then you can expect cost overruns, schedule slippage, and possibly total project failure. The Estimate Activity Resources process helps us to identify and quantify the resources required for each activity. For any given activity on our project, we may require some or all of these resources here: people, equipment, material, as well as goods or supplies. So even though we focus mainly on the topic of estimating what type of human resources are needed to perform our activities, we should never forget that our activities may also need some or all of the other types. Furthermore, when you estimate resources, you should also consider these four factors here, starting with the complexity of the task, then the skill level that is required of the resource, the organization's history in doing similar activities, and finally, the required resources availability. If you properly weigh these factors, you should be able to provide accurate estimates for the resources required. But let's dig a little deeper here, because when choosing resources, it's imperative that you give adequate consideration to what resource is best to doing a particular job. Let's say one of the activities on your project requires the digging of a 40 by 40 by 40 centimeter whole. How long this will take is dependent on your choice of resource. Suppose we have many of these holes to dig. We better choose our resource wisely, or it could take a long time. Well, if employing a six-year-old were not against the law, in most places, we would probably get a result in the region of 1 to 2 hours for that six-year-old to dig the hole. Probably not ideal, since many holes would be requiring a lot of time to be scheduled for this child to dig, say, 50, 60 holes like that. A better choice would be to employ an adult who could probably complete each hole in about 10 to 20 minutes. But if we had hundreds of these holes to dig, even that choice would not be optimal. A modern excavating machine would complete the task in only about 10 seconds. And so if you have hundreds of these holes to dig, it would likely be the best choice of resources here. And you probably also noticed that each of these choices would have a different cost attached to it. Let me also fill you in a little secret here. See the adorable dog on the image here on the right, who seems ever so ready to dig? Well, I was told that this dog would likely prefer hunting to digging. A terrier would be better for the digging job. So don't forget the skills of your resources either. I just mentioned cost a second ago because in addition to considering duration when choosing resources, it's also very important to look at these resources from a cost perspective. After all, each resource has a cost associated with them, and selecting one type of resource over another can have an impact on your project budget. But there is more to costs than simply the hourly rate. Know-how and experience is also connected to cost. Experience usually means greater productivity. If your resources don't have the appropriate know-how to perform a task, you must send them to be trained, and that costs money. Or you could decide that it's overall cheaper for you to simply hire the external resources who have the specialized know-how. Remember that the more experience a resource has, that resource will usually also cost more, and you have to account for this. Let's get our hands dirty and start planting some seeds of knowledge about this process, beginning with the inputs. We have four of them. Within the project management plan, you'll need the resource management plan as well as the schedule baseline. There are some interesting project documents that are especially helpful in the estimating processes. Enterprise environmental factors such as resource availability, location, and skill can all influence resource selection. And organizational process assets can also influence or even impact resource use. Most common examples are policies or procedures that address staffing, the rental or purchase of materials, equipment, and supplies. The project management plan and its subsidiary components may be quite large, so focus on those elements that we know that we need. First of all, we need the resource management plan, which shows us how we approach identifying all the required resources and how they will be quantified. And we'll need the scope baseline to see which activities need people or activities that require things or perhaps both. And lastly, the schedule baseline answers the question when. When does an activity start means that's also the when a resource may be required. Here are the project documents that we need. Activity attributes, which are the details that allow resource estimation for those activities. Details like successor activities, logical relationships, leads and lags, imposed dates and constraints, to name just a few. Then the activity list is a list of all activities that will require resources. Don't forget a list of the assumptions that we've made about our project. Then we also have the activity cost estimates. They can influence whether or not resources are used, and if so, what type of resources are used based on cost. Oh, and be careful, because cost and quality may be interdependent. Next, we have the resource calendars. They can be consulted to identify what resources, such as people or equipment, are available at a given time. And lastly, the risk register. It provides a list of risk events that may impact resources required, selected, or available. Each of these provides information needed to make accurate resource estimates. Here are a few of the commonly used enterprise environmental factors and organizational process assets. Starting with the EEFs, we have the resource location and availability, team resource skills, the organizational culture, and the marketplace conditions. And then on the other side, for the OPAs, we have standard HR policies, physical management procedures, as well as the history of resource uses on past similar projects. We have discussed most of them in other lessons, so I won't go into detail here. However, there is one factor I would like to look at with you, and that is the fact that we have to keep in mind that the choice of resource or quantity can potentially impact multiple project variables like time and cost. But how do we make these decisions without having an enormous base of knowledge about those factors and more? Well, that brings us to the fifth EEF that is missing here on the left-hand side. Because the answers to my question can be found in published estimating data. This data is indeed available, and it tells us how long it will take an excavator to dig a hole, how long it takes a skilled laborer to dig the same hole, or maybe even how long it takes a six-year-old to do the same job. I doubt that one, though. Similarly, there are catalogs available that give you the unit cost for labor, equipment, and material resources. And having these two pieces of information available, you can use the rate information and unit cost together to determine total cost of production for the resources selected. These sorts of external publications, whether industry-based or even government-created, may be very helpful since someone else has done all the brain work for us. Let's keep going and grab our spade and shovel as we learn all about the tools and techniques to estimate activity resources. We have quite a number of them to choose from, starting with one of our usual suspects here, expert judgment. Then we have three specific estimating tools, namely bottom-up estimating, analogous estimating, parametric estimating. We also have data analysis, your project management information system, and finally, meetings. That's the other usual suspect. Each of these tools and techniques helps you to estimate all the resources that you are going to need for the project. Expert judgment is the first tool and technique. Experts can provide real perspective when it comes to estimating resources for our activities. First off, experts can help the project staff choose the right resource based on their wealth of experience with similar projects or activities. Remember our earlier example about digging holes? I suppose the expert will not tell us to pick the six-year-old. Experience counts. Once we have decided on which resource is correct for the task, experts can then help us to determine how many of these resources we should employ for a given activity. Experts usually know the optimal number, so there is just enough work to go around and avoid idle time. Experts earn their big paychecks also by sharing their knowledge and insights about requirements for a given activity that is common in their area of expertise. Experts can give us choices of different techniques for estimating, and because they have seen many different situations, experts can typically also provide a range of choices of resources appropriate for a given activity. Next, we have the three common estimating techniques that you have already seen in both cost management as well as schedule management lessons. Bottom-up estimating is often on PMP exams. It's a PMP exam favorite because even though it is time-consuming, it is the most accurate of estimating approaches. Some call it the engineering or grassroots estimate because of the level of detail involved. The key is in the detail. When you break down an enormous task into smaller, more manageable tasks, then the task becomes small enough to make a considered estimate for the required resources. After you assign people equipment, material, and supplies, you get a total for that single task. Add up all these estimates, and that is bottom-up estimating. When each and every task on the WBS has its own detailed estimates, the number can be aggregated at a different level or totaled for the entire project. Analogous estimating is certainly quicker and easier. This method uses the common features of similar past projects based on recent historical data. And then parametric estimates are simple math tools. They are algorithm-based. If you have current up-to-date data, you can use a formula to make an estimate based on proven relationships. For example, a paving company knows its past cost per lane mile paved and even the cost of a mile of painted centerline. Very handy, but using this tool requires current, accurate, and relevant data. We are moving on to our next tool and technique, which is data analysis, where we take the time to look at the activity resource-related information so we can organize, assess, and evaluate them. We want to look at a particular type of data analysis that is all about alternatives. Just as we have choices of how we derive energy, we have choices of what resources to assign to the various project tasks. As project managers, our project team and often experts will assist us in identifying several resource options for our activities. When choosing resources, we must first determine what is the best choice and why. Is it faster? Is faster always the best? And what about reliability? And what about quality? The analysis of alternatives should consider all the ways to accomplish the activity. Should the task be done manually, or is automation a better choice? Questions such as whether it makes sense to do the work in-house or use external resources need to be considered when estimating resources. Very often, project managers will also have to consider whether it makes more sense to build it or buy it or even rent it. For example, software. Should we build it ourselves or purchase it from a vendor? Both the requirements of an activity or its product, as well as the current environment, will limit our choice of alternatives. One example that immediately comes to mind is a resource shortage and its effect on cost and considerations in regards to alternatives. So, as you see, there are many considerations when choosing and estimating the resources required for the project activities, and it's good to have alternatives. The project management information system, and of course in particular project management software, is definitely something you are going to want to use. Contemporary software is sophisticated enough to consider several factors when estimating resources, such as the resource breakdown structure, the resource calendars, and rates and cost. And having these all in one package will allow you to create instant alternatives for comparisons in order to see the potential scheduling conflicts and resource shortages or overbooking problems. And that is how project management software will support us in our endeavor of estimating activity resources. And now that we have applied our tools and techniques to the various inputs, we come to the outputs. We have a total of four outputs here in Estimate Activity Resources. We have the Activity Resource Requirements. This is a key listing of what types and quantities of resources will be needed by all activities on the WBS. Indeed, it can directly affect cost and quality. Then we also have the basis of estimates, also called the BOE in some organizations. They provide the rationale for each estimate, the resource breakdown structure, and the project document updates. Let's discuss these outputs further. The goal of this process is to identify and estimate what kind of and how many resources are needed for each activity in a work package. Therefore, the Activity Resource Requirements list contains the quantity and type of resources for each activity or task on the WBS. It can be used to aggregate the total resources required in a work package or a work period. It will often contain the details involved in creating the estimate for each resource and the assumptions that were used to determine the resources estimated. This output is a vital piece which becomes indispensable as an input for other processes. The basis or rationale for each estimate is a handy reference document to remind us how we created our estimates. Let's see what's involved. The basis of estimates, the BOE, supports the activity resource requirements. It is a key source for finding the methods used to develop the estimate, analogous or parametric, for example, and it includes the assumptions and the type of resources used. For example, did we use a six-year-old or machines to do the digging? Were there any constraints affecting this estimate? And since estimates are predictions of the future and cover a range of possibilities, we should be able to attach a level of confidence to each. And finally, has our estimating activity revealed or introduced any new risks? The resource breakdown structure is our third output. It's a great way of showing required resources in a graphical format. Our example here includes only the human resources that are needed in each of these three categories here. Of course, you could have other categories like labor, material, equipment, supplies, and so on. Take a look at the welding category. Here you see an example that includes the skill level of our resources because we have a master welder as well as one other category, an apprentice welder. And now we complete our example here with the transportation as well as the plumbing. Notice something. We're only talking about categories here. We haven't yet assigned individuals. We haven't yet people. We would need to consider the different roles and types of resources that we need, which may include required licenses and certifications, skill or grade levels, or knowledge and experience. And finally, because we have done quite a bit of work in this process here, there are a number of project documents that may require updates. For example, the activity attributes, the assumptions log, and the lessons learned register could be among them. And that was the last of the outputs here in the Estimate Activity Resources process. Let's see what we can take away from this lesson. Why do we estimate activity resources? Well, we want to estimate how many and what type of resources we will need on our project. And how exactly do we accomplish this? We analyze the type and the quantity of resources that we need for each scheduled activity so that we can accurately estimate the activity duration. We apply expert judgment and alternative analysis in order to document activity resource requirements in the activity attributes of our activity list. And we also create a resource breakdown structure. And that concludes our look at the Estimate Activity Resources process. Until next time.